24th chapter of Mandukya Upanishad. The last topic Gaudapada Acharya was discussing was the fundamental human problem. The root cause of the human problem is the ajnanam, ignorance. So, samsara karanam ajnanam, and the means of attainment of freedom from that samsara is the knowledge, attainment of the knowledge. Samsara nivritti hetuhu, nivritti sadhanam is jnanam. This is what he has been discussing. Now from 76th verse onwards, 75th or 76th verse onwards, Karika onwards, he has been discussing that. Before that he summarized the vision of Vedanta, Vedantic teaching, the whole Vedantic vision, the essence of the Vedantic teaching, he summarized verses before that. And then 76th onwards, he has been discussing the samsara karanam and samsara nivritti sadhanam, the means of, the only means of the removal of samsara is jnanam. The last class we saw, let us read the, I think we were in the 80th verse. Let us see the 80th verse now. Nivruttasya pravruttasya,
nivruttasya pravruttasya,
nischalahitadasthitihi,
nischalahitadasthitihi,
vishayasahibuddhanam, tatsamyamajamadvayam,
tatsamyamajamadvayam.
So this 80th karika is discussing, talking about the wise person, ajnani. And also talking about the, what is peace of mind, isn't it? So, nivruttaha means, literally it means retired, but here it means what? The one who is free from all wrong notions. Thereby, one who is free from ajnanam, thereby one who is free from the erroneous, perception. It means one whose perception is no more erroneous, one who has right identity. One who has right identity means what? One who has this vision of one's own self being the consciousness Brahman. Turiyam, limitless consciousness, such a person is called Nivruttaha. He is relieved, of all the problems, of all the miseries. He is free from all the miseries. It means one who has objectivity. One who is objective towards everything in life. One who is not subjective anymore. One who does not internalize any problems of the body, mind, sense complex, or any problems, any situations as something which afflicts him, isn't it? One who is objective towards everything. So be in being objective, one is free. In being subjective, one is bound, because there is no internalization of anything. Hacha person, a wise person, is nivruttaha, therefore apravruttaha. One who is apravruttaha means one who is not involved in any of the activities, depending upon the fruits of actions for his happiness and security. Such a person is apravruttaha, does not mean physically inactive person. This wise person who is physically active but who is still one who is not dependent on fruits of actions for his happiness or security, such a person is apravruttaha. Therefore, Nivruttaha apravruttaha, such a person has a mind, and this, how is his mind? Nischala sthitihi manasaha. For such a person's mind alone is what? No, tada nischala sthitihi. Nischala sthitihi means absolutely tranquil, serene, no, peaceful. His mind is what? Which is not, no situation, external situation really causes any disturbance or agitation. He is unshaken. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, this guruna api dukkhena na vichalyate. One who is not shaken by even the worst of pain. No, death happens, losses happen, dishonor comes, nothing shakes this person, isn't it? Which means because of his objectivity. That tranquility of the mind is called what? No, nischala sthitihi. Nischala sthitihi is a state of mind, isn't it? The absolute tranquility, serenity, the peacefulness is a state of mind which is enjoyed by this wise person. And that mind, such a state of mind, he says here, buddhanam vishayaha. Buddhanam vishayaha means what now? Such a state of mind is available for experience only for wise people. Buddhaha here means the person who has recognized the truth as his own self is the buddhaha here. Buddhaha means arinyan. Tamil we say buddhaha. No, arivadi we say. No? The wise person. So, the person who has recognized his swarupam being Turiya Chaitanyam, who is cognitively, the buddhaha is the one who has cognitively shifted the ahankara, I sense, from body mansions complex and then resolved it in consciousness, which means for whom I is equal to consciousness. I, the self, am Turiyam, the consciousness, distinct from Vishwa Taijasa Pragyaha. Isn't it? The Vishwaha Taijasaha Pragyaha, every experiencer obtaining in every state of experience, mind is none other than consciousness. But the consciousness is not any of this experiencer. Isn't it? Therefore, one who is distinct from all the three, that which alone is in the form of Vishwatajasa Pragya, that Turiyam consciousness, Chaitanyam alone, Ahamasmi, I am that consciousness, awareness. One who has a clear vision is here called Buddhaha. Only for such a wise person, Ajnani, this tranquility is available for experience. Understand? Vishayaha. Vishaya means what now? It is available, it is experienceable only for wise people. Absolute tranquility, serenity, isn't it? Is possible. Vishayaha, buddhanam hi vishayaha. And that, such a state of mind, what is that tranquil mind? What is the tranquil mind or state of mind? The tranquility of the mind, serenity of the mind, peace of mind. What is the peace of mind? The state of mind. So for a wise person, everything here is Brahma, isn't it? All that is, there is only Brahma. Means, what about the peace of mind or peaceful mind? Peaceful mind, peace of mind. What is that mind? That mind also is Brahma. For him, peace is, tranquility is non-separate from Brahma. The tranquility of the mind is also what? Brahman only. Therefore he says, that verse says, for whom everything is Brahma, and that peace is also Brahman for him. Tat samyam ajam advayam. That peace of mind is what? Samyam. Samyam, peace of mind is Brahman, which is there everywhere equally, and which is not object to, which is of the nature of changelessness, ajam, advayam, which is one secondless non-dual reality. The peace of mind is equated to turiyam, chaitanyam, the atma, the brahman, the consciousness. Okay? Which means everything is Brahma. Peace also is what? Brahma. Peace of mind is what? Brahma. Peaceful mind is what? Brahma. Which Brahma? The Brahman which is Advayam, Ajam, Samyam. Which is there in everything equally and which is there as non-dual, secondless reality and which is of the nature of changelessness. The changeless reality, consciousness, Brahman, his peace is that Brahma. Okay. And here, what is that? What is that Atma? What is that peace of mind? Is going to further explain in the following Karika. Let us read it now. So here, Atma Swarupam is discussed in this 81st Karika also. Ajam Nidrama Swapnam.
Ajam Nidrama Swapnam.
Prabhatam Bhavati Swayam.
Prabhatam Bhavati Swayam.
Sakridvibhato He Vaisha.
Sakridvibhato He Vaisha.
Dharmo Dhatu Swabhavatah.
Dharmo Dhatu Swabhavatah.
Ajama Nidrama Swapnam.
Ajama Nidrama Swapnam.
Prabhatam Bhavati Swayam.
Prabhatam Bhavati Swayam.
Sakridvibhato He Vaisha.
Sakridvibhato He Vaisha.
Dharmo Dhatu Swabhavatah.
Dharmo Dhatu Swabhavatah.
So here he says, Yeshaha, Yeshaha means what? Here he means, Yeshaha, Yeshaha Dharmaha. Be careful, in this Karika, the word Dharmaha means Atma. That is why it's not Purusharta Dharma. Understand? So we have to be, that is why when Hari Shastram, which word means what in which context, it might be very clear. The word Dharmaha always understood as what? Purusharta, isn't it? Arthakama Dharma Moksha. But here, Dharmaha also means Ishvara. But here, Dharmaha means what? Atma. Dharmaha. This Eshaha Dharmaha. The Dharmaha, here the Atma, is of the nature of peace and tranquility. Tranquility is the very swarupam of the Atma. Dharmaha, Ajam. Now, who is this Atma here? Dharmaha. He is going to say one by one now. Ajam. This Ajaha. Atma Ajaha. Anidraha. Atma Anidraha, Aswapnam, Atma Aswapnaha, and Atma Swayam Prabhatam Bhavati, Atma Sakrit Vibhataha Bhavati, Atma Swabhavataha Dhatuhu, Dhatu Swabhavataha. Every word is what? That description of the Atma. Description of the Atma means what? Not actually description. We know Atma is non-describable. But every word reveals the swarupam of the Atma. Ajam means what? Birthless, unborn. Birthlessness also implies what? Changelessness, isn't it? The word Ajam negates Atma being the Turiyam, the consciousness, Turiya Chaitanyam, the fourth Padaha. When you are studying this Mandukya Karika, we have to use the terms of Mandukya Upanishad, isn't it? So, Ajaha means Atma, the Turiya, the Chaturtha Padaha, the fourth Padaha, Turiyaha, Atma, the consciousness, which is distinct from, which is free from, which is unassociated from the physical body. So ajaha implies, even though ajaha means changelessness, ajaha means atma, which is of the nature of changelessness, which means birthlessness, that what is implied by this atma being free from sthula shariram. So sthula sharira rahitaha or sthula sharira sambandha rahitaha. The one who is free from gross physical body. Understand, no connection. Consciousness has no connection with what? The gross body. It means no sambandha with the gross body. Consciousness is free from, distinct from the gross body. That's what sthula shariram is negated by the word ajaha. Then anidraha. Why negate now? Which means, what are you here? Aham turiyaha atma, the chaitanyam, distinct from the sthula shariram, ajaha. Then anidraha. Let us go to the aswapnaha first, then come back to anidraha. Next is aswapnaha. Swapnaha is what now? Aswapnaha means one who is free from dream. So dream happens where dream is actually projection of the one's own subtle thoughts, isn't it? The vasanas, the samskaras, the mental impressions which we have accumulated, collected through during the waking state, they are in the form of subtle thoughts in our subconscious. So the samskaras, the vasanas, the mental impressions in the form of subtle thoughts and subconscious, which have been collected and stored during our waking experience, they alone become replayed, isn't it? In waking state, our mind functions as a record player. In dream state, it's a replaying of the recording, isn't it? So replaying of what has been recorded during the waking state. And where is it happening now? The replaying happens only in the mind. Therefore, swapnam is it what? No, mind. Mind belongs to what? Mind is formed part of the sukshma shariram. Therefore, aswapnaha negates the sukshma shariram. Aswapnaha means the turiyam the chaitanyam, turiyaha atma the chaitanyam, free from sukshma shariram. So aswapnaha negates the subtle body. Ajaha negates the gross body. Understand now? Therefore, which means I am the consciousness, the atma, distinct from the subtle body also. See, the words, we don't have a direct meaning here. What it negates is what? The sukshma shariram is negated. Then sthula shariram has been negated. Sukshma also has been negated. Now, what is left behind now? Only karna shariram, isn't it? That is going to be negated by the other word, anidram, isn't it? Yeshaha dharmaha, yeshaha atma, anidraha. Anidra, nidra means what? Sleep. Sleep, it associated with what? Karana shariram, avidya, isn't it? So therefore, sleep is associated with the karana shariram. Who falls asleep? Does atma sleep?
No.
The sleep is again associated with the karana shariram, causal body, we say. Avidya, isn't it? Therefore, anidraha means atma the turiyam, the consciousness, is distinct from the causal body also. Which means no connection or association whatsoever with any of these threefold bodies. So sukshma, what is the actual meaning here? Ajam anidram aswapnam is equal to atma sthula sukshma karana sharira vyatirittaha. You have to go back to Tattvabodha class, kindergarten class, isn't it? There you had it as what? Atma kaha sthula sukshma karana sharirad vyatirittaha. is it all pervasive, innermost essence, the consciousness obtaining as the very swarupam of the I, the truth of I is distinct from, different from the body, mind, sense complex, the sthool, gross body, subtle body and causal body obtaining in him of sleep is in ignorance, the total ignorance. Therefore, the first three words negate Atma being distinct from the causal, subtle and gross bodies. Is it clear? Okay. Ajam, Anidram, Aswapnam. And such consciousness, the Atma, which is distinct from all the three bodies, Swayam Prabhatam Bhavati. Swayam Prabhatam Bhavati. It is of the nature of self-effulgence. It is ever evident self because of its self-effulgence. Swayam Prabhatam Bhavati means Atma, the consciousness, Turiya Atma, the consciousness, is not dependent on the function of the mind or senses to become evident. Isn't it? When the mind functions, when sense organs function, only then the world becomes evident. When does the world become evident? The world is evident, world enjoys the status of being existent only when it becomes evident, and the world becomes evident only when the mind and sense organs function. Isn't it? They're dependent on the function of the mind and sense organs. But Turiya Atma, the consciousness, is not dependent on the function of mind and senses for it to become evident. Is always ever evident, which means it is independently evident. That's called, that is what is said to be, it is self-effulgence. Atma is of the nature of self-effulgence means what? Thane vilangukira parambarul. It is of the nature of self-effulgence means what? It is independently evident, not dependently evident. The world is dependently evident. Whereas Atma is independently evident. How do we say it is self-evident? It is of the nature of self-effulgence. How do we say that? In deep sleep state, isn't it? Even though, when the mind and sense organs are non-functional, when the world is not evident, but the world being not evident, the absence of experience of the world is experienced. Because of what? Because of the Atma. Isn't it? Therefore we say, from that we understand Atma is independently evident, means self-evident. Atma is of the nature of self-effulgence. That is what is said by this expression, Swayam Prabhatam Bhavati. Swayam Prabhatam Bhavati. The next, Sakrit Vibhataha. Sakrit Vibhataha means what? It is, Vibhata means it is ever evident, it is always shining. No time Atma is not shining. It means it is always shining. In waking state, Atma is very much there as experience of the waking universe. In deep dream, it is there. In deep sleep state, Atma is there. Which situation Atma is not there? Atma is there always. Atma obtains as the experiencer in every state of experience. There is no time Atma does not shine. There is no time Atma disappears. For a short while, we go back and come, rest and come back. No. There is no such a thing called Atma, no, being not there. Sakrit Vibhataha means Sada Vibhataha, that which shines always. Yeshaha Dharmaha, then Swabhavataha Dhatuhu. Swabhavataha Dhatuhu means what? Dhatu Swabhavataha means Dhatuhu means intrinsically it is of the nature of consciousness, existence. Okay? Atma is of the nature of what? What is the swarupam of this self? What is the nature of this self? What is the nature of the reality? We say consciousness. And what is consciousness? Is pure existence also. Which means the world enjoys existence. The world does not have existence, independent existence. It has existence borrowed from what? The existence of the Atma is the existence of the world. And here, and also the consciousness also, if you say, in Kena Upanishad, the very first mantra, the teacher's question, the student is asking the question, what is that? I know very, this is a very intelligent student, he says very clearly, I know the physical body is elemental product. It must be of the nature of inertness, but it is not inert now, it is conscious and sentient. For it to become conscious and sentient, he knows or there is something which is indwelling the physical body, which subtle body, all the subtle imperceptible factors are there. And they are also material products. The seeing power, hearing power, all the powers, the pranas, isn't it? The mind, antakaram, they're all in, even the mind also is what? Material product. But even though the mind and sense powers, all the powers of organs of actions, or the entire subtle body is also what? Is the material product. It must be inert in nature. But now it is not inert. It is conscious, it is sentient, it is functional. Not only that, it is capable of making the gross body also conscious. It would have been like a piece of wood, isn't it? Like just a wood. That is why we have wholeheartedly, we take the 80, 90 kilos, 80, 60 kilos of the physical body and wholeheartedly we take it, put in the crematorium, we'll cremate the body wholeheartedly without any even smallest operation means you have to get local anesthesia and that and this. But when the cremation comes, we know, nobody says, oh, don't do that. Why won't say that? We know very well this body is like a wood, log of wood. It can be just pushed into the crematorium and it can be cremated. Nobody feels sorry, sad. People feel sorry because the purses are not available for that for us. Otherwise, nobody feels sorry for the body being burnt. Because we know the body has no pain, nothing. Why? Because what is that? You know, which makes this gross material kattai insentient and it is the subtle body. What about subtle body? Subtle body is also inert matter only, but still subtle body becomes conscious and sentient because of the blessing of Atma. Isn't it? Therefore, that consciousness, it first of all, it becomes conscious and sentient and it lends existence and consciousness to the physical body also. Which means that consciousness, what he said here, swabhavataha dhatuhu, means what? Intrinsically, Atma is consciousness. Whereas here, body is not intrinsically conscious. Isn't it? So it enjoys the borrowed, consciousness. Mind and sense organs also what now? Have their borrowed sentiency and consciousness. Whereas the reality, the substance of the substantive, I is the very consciousness itself. Consciousness is what? Swabhavataha dhatuhu. Dhatuhu swabhavataha. It is intrinsically conscious. It very nature is being conscious. Whereas the mind and sense organs they cannot become conscious. They are not consciousness, they become conscious because of the blessing of consciousness. Therefore, it's not borrowed nature, it is the intrinsic nature. That is what is said here as the swabhavataha dhatuhu. Dhatu swabhavataha. Dhatu swabhavataha. So what now? He says, it is this consciousness. The Turiyam is, what is Turiyam? The Chaturtha Padaha Turiyaha, the Atma, the consciousness, which is of this nature, for a wise person, the absolute tranquility which he enjoys as a state of mind is non-separate from this Atma. Absolute peace and peace, tranquility and consciousness are inseparable. Understand? It's also Brahma. And that is only a wise person can have it. That's what is said in this 81st Karika. Okay. Let's go to the 82nd Karika now. Sukhama vrigate nityam.
Sukhama vrigate nityam.
Dukham vivrigate sada.
Dukham vivrigate sada.
Yasya kasya cha dharmasya.
Yasya kasya cha dharmasya.
Grahena bhagavanasau.
Grahena bhagavanasau.
Come to the front. Here an important discussion comes in this verse. Karika looks very, very tiny. Okay, but you have to understand a lot here. Here, having Purushartha Nischayaha, knowing the value of knowledge, and you understand the importance of the study of the Shastram, and studying it with the help of the teacher also, even after having attained the knowledge of the self, even after knowing clearly, I am consciousness, Aham Brahma Asmi. This is very clear in the class, isn't it? Because logically, without any contradiction with the reasoning, you understood very clearly, definitely, I, the self, no, I, the knower, experiencer, am consciousness, distinct from the body, mind, and complex. And second thing, also understood what? Everything here is Brahma, nothing which is not Brahma. The Jiva, Ishvara, Swarupa, Aikyam also is very clear that we don't have many experiencers. The experiencer, the one who obtains the experiencer in every mind is what? The consciousness alone. Like what? How the illuminator, there are so many opaque things are illumined here. Even though you illumined objects are many, opaque things are many, the illuminator, we never say illuminators of the opaque things. Illuminator is always a singular word. Illuminator is one and the same. Like that, the knower, experiencer, the experiences are many, the experienced minds are many, experienced objects are many, but experiencer is ever one and the only consciousness. We know very clearly. But I am, the experiencer, I am consciousness, distinct from all of them. When you understand Jiva, Brahma Aikyam, Jiva Ishvara Swarupa Aikya Jnanam. We have no doubt. Because it is the consciousness which alone is there in all the minds, obtaining as the experiencer, as the substance or the substantive I. In every mind is what? Consciousness. When you understand, I am consciousness, everyone is consciousness. It's very clear. Now what about the matter? The matter also has no independent existence outside of consciousness. Therefore, there is no matter other than consciousness. All these material forms and the matter itself, nothing but, what is that? The consciousness in seeming motion is this entire Jagat. Which means there Jagat Brahma Aikyam also is there. You are resolving the I, the individual, you resolve in the Jagat also in same Brahman. Then you resolving the knower, known duality in consciousness. Isn't it? So the knower, known Dvaita Prapancha, duality, the world of duality, the knower, known duality, you resolve in the, through the, in the vision of the non-duality of the reality. The consciousness is a non-dual, secondless, only reality which is free from knower, known difference. There is no knower other than consciousness. There is no known other than consciousness. This is very clear. We have Sarvam Brahma. All that is here is only Brahma. So Aham Brahmasmi Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma is clear. But still what happens? We are after understanding also. When we have to transact in this world, do we remember this knowledge always? We know, but we seem to forget this knowledge. Isn't it? See, when you have the experience of the dream world, in dream you are going through all dream experiences and the dream pain and dream problems and dream fear, dream jealousy, dream, you know, pains and pleasures you have go through. But all the dream problems that you went through in dream, they just resolve once you wake up, isn't it? On waking up from sleep, the dream world instantaneously resolves. The dream world does not continue to exist when you wake up from sleep. Very easy, isn't it? When you are a waker, your identity is with, as a waker, then the dream world resolves. The dream world does not continue to exist. Dream world disappears, therefore dream problems are not there in the waking state. Whereas, when you through the study of the Shastram, when you understand yourself being Atma, the consciousness, Turiya Chaitanyam, when you see everything else as Brahman also, this knowledge you get when as a waker in the waking state. After being awake to the nature of one's reality also, this waking universe does not disappear like the dream world. Do you get the point what I'm saying? It is easy. The dream problems resolve when you wake up from sleep. The dream world does not exist anymore for you as a waker. Whereas, as a waker, when you through study of the Shastram, when you understand the fact that I am consciousness, I am Turiyam the Brahman, still this external gross universe, waking universe, continues to exist. It doesn't disappear like a dream. It is there. After knowing the knowledge, attaining the knowledge also, after knowing the truth also, still you are perceiving duality. So perception of the duality will be there. Experiences will be there. The world continues to exist. Same friends and people will continue to be there. Same situations, everything will be exactly like before. Nothing changes. Externally, the world does not change. The Jagat is as it was before. Before Ajnanam, whatever the world of transaction you had in front of you, the same world of transaction continues to be there even as a wise person. Even as a person knows the truth. Isn't it? Then why the world continues to be there for you? Because of your prarabdha. Even though the wise person is not afflicted by the prarabdha, now every day when you fall asleep, in sleep, jnani, ajnani, all of us are same. No sukham dukkham for ajnani also in sleep. No sukham and dukkham for a wise person also. Isn't it the same? But the dream and the tajasa, and the waking experiences are still there, for the difference is there. When you wake up, the world continues to be there. And who wakes you up every day? Every day, our prarabdha wakes you up, wakes us up. Today's bread is still in your account. Now, so many number of toasts are there. So, that account, we have to finish, settle the account. Whatever pleasure you deserve, nice mermaid, everything is there. What is that? Everything is there, isn't it? All those things you have to exhaust. Punyam, you have to finish it. Paradha karmapalam, papam, some unpleasant experiences also will be there. So every day, I tell you, nobody can escape. Sleep is a temporary moksha. And then you are woken up by your prarabdha. Karma palam wakes you up to go through the punyam and papam in your account, that particular day. Every day you are exhausting bit by bit, little by little, our prarabdha karma palam. Not sanchitamaka, only prarabdha exhausting. Because prarabdha is there, even after jnanam, isn't it? The jagat continues to exist. Then what happens? When you want to wake up, you are as a waker. I the waker am Turiyam, the consciousness. If you remember always, that would be good. And when you interact with the world, when you come in contact with the external world on waking up from sleep, there is perception of duality which cannot be removed. The perception will be there. For a wise person or for a good person, duality will be the same. Perception of duality will be there. But only difference is, in wise person has a conclusion, this duality is mithya. Whereas a good person will think duality is real. That's the only difference, isn't it? The conclusions of a wise, conclusion of the wise person is different from the conclusion of an ignorant person. But perception is the same. Perception is the same, which means the perception of duality is the same for a wise person and for an ignorant person. But the conclusion about the perception alone is different. Is it clear? Before we are seeing the world, when you come in contact with the world, when you wake up, suppose imagine this person is a grihastha jnani, a wise who knows, who studied the shastram, but understood very clearly, aham brahmasmi, sarvam khalvidam brahma. But when he wakes up, first he sees the grandchild coming, finished. And then what happened now? When you see the grandson, there is a waker, Vishwaha is invoked, ahankara is invoked. What ahankara is invoked here? My grandson is coming, nothing wrong. Immediately what now? You become the role. I am a grandfather, role is invoked. Then my son comes, I am a father, that is invoked. My daughter comes, I am a father, I am a mother. In that role play, role is invoked in you. The invocation of all these different roles. Now my friend comes. So the different, definitely all invoked here. When they invoked, immediately all those things, the problems and worries connected to the, the daughter comes, oh my God, when is she going to get married, when am I going to sort out this problem? The grandchild comes, he has not yet gone to school, I should go and talk to somebody to get the admission for him. Like that, all sorts of things come to your mind, isn't it? The problems and the worries which go with that particular individual we associate with, they all surface. When they surface, that time, because in spite of knowing all these things, in spite of knowing very clearly that aham brahmasmi is very clear one side. But when we are transacting with the world, ego is again invoked. as a waker is invoked, ego is invoked. Why? Because you're interacting with the world, the people. And somebody comes, immediately all the past experience with that person come to your mind. Either there may be raga or dvesha. Oh, this person, you know how much he cheated me? Suddenly that anger also will come. Oh my God, this person, how much he helped me, you know. Immediately that raga also comes. Raga or dvesha, they all will be invoked when you see the things associated with that person, they all get provoked and invoked. Then what happens? It is very easy, it's all our knowledge, aham turiya atma, the consciousness, that knowledge gets pushed back. I am the waker, isn't it? My role becomes the prominent. The knowledge is there. In spite of having the knowledge, that role play becomes prominent. The real nature becomes pushed to the back. Which means what? It is forgotten temporarily. Exactly when you have to remember, that is when you forget. When you're alone, nobody is there in front of you. You don't need to aham brahmasmi, aham brahmasmi, aham brahmasmi. You don't need to say all the time. See, this knowledge has to be remembered, as it must be very effortless. It must be there all the time. Then what happens? The knowledge is forgotten. The forgotten knowledge is as good as ignorance. How ignorance is of no use, similarly, forgotten knowledge also is of, doesn't help you, as good as ignorance. I told this even in the previous, some other class, I told you. The two, you know, the two children go for the examination. One child goes without studying anything to the examination. So doesn't write anything. Comes back, you know, failing in the examination. Other child worked very hard, the whole night he studied. Went to the examination hall, forgot everything. So he all does not write anything. Both of them fail. Which means, in spite of studying the Shastram, in spite of understanding everything, in spite of knowing Aham Brahmasmi, I am consciousness, no doubt there. I am the knower, different from the known. Subject is different from the object. Grammar also you are very clear. So the knower, there's no knower other than consciousness. So I am consciousness. Consciousness is the only reality, which is the existence of the whole jagat. Therefore, I am the reality, limitless reality, which is of the nature of fullness. Because we understood how Atma is of the nature of timelessness and changelessness and spatial limitlessness. It is free from object limitations. Understood in the class. And everything is Brahma. It's all very clear. But in playing roles, okay, in role play also, we have to remember, we don't remember. No, I am a conscious being having temporary human experience. That must be there. But what happens? I am a human being waiting for spiritual experience. Understand? You have to be waiting throughout your life. I'll come back next gen also. You will, you know, we are waiting for a spiritual experience. You have to put it otherwise. I am a consciousness. I'm a conscious being having incidental, temporary human experience. I'm always conscious being. But here what I am a human being means I have to work for spiritual experience, means you'll be working throughout. I have to change the sentence. So human experience is a relative incidental thing for us. Over here we forget. that in the waker, because the jagat continues to exist, and it is easy for us to forget our, we don't remember, we forget. And one, what becomes prominent, dominant, is our waker. The Turiya Atma is not remembered, gets pushed back. It's not, it is there, but where is it? It goes and hides somewhere. And our, all our transactions, our behavior is what now? Is based on our identity as a waker, as the one who, no, who all identities completely with what now? Role play. Don't need to anything else. Any object in the front is enough. Any, you know, son comes, daughter comes, when you see them also, isn't it? We, having concern for them is different. But understand that the identity, without giving up the identity, we should be doing the things. But here, wrong identity. Where is the knowledge gone? Over here he says, in this context, what should we do for that? This jnanam has to become jnana nishtha. This verse indirectly emphasizes the assimilation, ascertainment of the knowledge which we have got through Shravanam. That assimilated knowledge is unforgettable knowledge, which is wisdom, which is called what? Jnana Nishtha. Jnanam has, first from ignorance, you have to be, attain jnanam. Ignorance has to be resolved through the attainment of knowledge. This knowledge has to be converted into jnana nishtha, ascertained knowledge. What should we do for that? For to convert the jnanam into jnana nishtha. See, to move from ignorance to knowledge, you need to do shravanam. But to convert the jnanam into jnana nishtha, you need nididhyasanam, meditation, no? Vedantic meditation. The other way is called contemplation. In Vedantic meditation, according to Vedanta Shastram, Vedanta meditation means what? Atma Swarupa Dhyanam. Dwelling upon one's own real nature, which has been unfolded, you know, through the words of the Shastram. Repeatedly, we have to be contemplative. That's why contemplation itself is impossible. This is where Shastram says contemplation is the only way for you to convert the knowledge into jnanam, into jnana nishtha. The knowledge into assimilated, ascertained, unforgettable knowledge, for which you need this is where we have to say, we are emphasizing, meditation is the only way. Because here you know what to meditate on. Shravanam has helped you understand what to meditate on. Therefore, in Nididhyasanam, you are able to be meditative. So, constantly, continuously, repeatedly dwelling upon one's own real nature alone will help you assimilate this. Then, even if you are, you're up, every day, your Parabdha Karma wakes you up. When you wake up, you see yourself, yes, I'm a waker now, but I, the waker, am absolutely unafflicted consciousness, Turiya Atma. That you should remember in the morning, before going to bed also, what now? When you go back also, you have to remember. Play the roles objectively the whole day, the morning and the evening. This must be there, which means the whole day there must be Nididhyasana is a must. So Gaudapada Acharyaji emphasizes Nididhyasana indirectly here. only then knowledge will be fruitful, effective. Only then you can enjoy the freedom which you are having. Otherwise you will be like another ignorant person. Understand? So he says in this Karika, see the second line here. Yasya kasyacha dharmasya grahena. Yasya kasyacha dharmasya grahena means what? Grahena means grahanam, here means in perceiving, okay, perception of any object in this world. In waking state, even though you have studied the shastram, understood the fact, when you are interacting with the world, grahana means interaction with the world, the contact. Yasya kasicha means any given object, any one object or any one person or the other, in perceiving, in contacting. Now, once you wake up, means your sense organs cannot help. You are perceiving the world, you're experiencing the world. The objects are experienced. Isn't it? Yasya kasyacha grahena, in perceiving any object, any person in front of you, the waking state, asau bhagavan. See, the beautifully he used the word bhagavan here. Asau bhagavan, who is the bhagavan here? He uses the word bhagavan to mean atma here, your own self. Your real self is Bhagavan. Now very clear, we don't need to go and search for Bhagavan anywhere. Bhagavan is not the one who is sitting in Kailasam or Vaikuntham. Who is Bhagavan here? They're all forms, isn't it? But here Bhagavan is the formless, all-pervasive, one and the only, secondless, non-dual reality, the consciousness obtaining as the truth of every individual, every being is all what here? Bhagavan. Asau Bhagavan, this Turiya Chaitanyam, the Turiya Atma, Asau Bhagavan. When we are interacting with the world in the waking state, when we come in contact with the external world of objects, In perception of every object or every person, aso poor Bhagavan, what happens now? He says, Vavriyate. He says, Avriyate. Avriyate Nithyam. Always completely covered. How? Sukham means what? Easily forgotten. Sukham is an adverb here. Effortlessly, easily we forget ourselves or forget our real nature. When do you forget our real nature? As a waker, when you wake up from sleep, when you are in contact with the external world of objects, then our individuality is invoked, our ahankara is invoked, the vishwaha is invoked, then every object we come in contact with, what now, provokes all our emotions. Because those worries or pains or pleasures that go with the object. See, that is why in some Tamil language, wife is called samsaram. Wife is named as samsara. Poor wife, okay? Not husband samsara for a wife. In Tamil language, in villages in India, they won't ask, you know, where is your wife? They won't ask. They'll say, my samsara will not come. Samsara varlingi veetla. They say, because the once in the morning you wake up and see her finished. Everything comes go with this. The whole, which means not only wife here, as a husband for the wife, the children also for the parents, and the parents for the children, not only, now the whole jagat for then friends and associates and colleagues, everybody was born now. when he had to go and work in an office, had to put up with this boss or manager or subordinate. My God, everyone comes with their own baggage, isn't it? They have their own way of behavior. Completely behavior is governed by their own minds. And you can't understand why the behavior is like that. They have their own reasons. Nobody can, which is obviously says beautifully, nobody can behave differently from the way one behaves. Every behavior is completely governed by one's own mind. Isn't it complete one's own state of mind, condition? That is why, and then there we don't, that provokes, invokes, isn't it? Raga, dvesha. Which means in interaction with the world, grahane. Yasya kasya cha vishayasya grahane. When you're perceiving the external world of objects, definitely what happens? All those thoughts associated with the object, the person, the people, when they surface, your Vishwa is dominantly sitting there, the waker is there. I am the waker, that alone is very strongly there. What happens now? Sukham effortlessly, Aham Brahmasmi, that jnanam very well understood in the class, avriyate, completely covered. Your knowledge is covered. Knowledge is our knowledge, which you have got, which you attained through Shravanam in the class, becomes covered. Before it was covered by ignorance, isn't it? Before Shravanam, our knowledge is covered by ignorance. Now our knowledge is not covered by ignorance, but knowledge is covered by overwhelming, isn't it? The flowing emotions and thoughts which rise associated with the objects we are experiencing in the world. Thoughts connected to, associated with the objects we are perceiving. They all come up. And they come, what happened, even when they rise also, you are not objective. What happens? Because your identity is with the waking, the shariram, therefore you see yourself as the waker when you're interacting with the world. Isn't it? What happened? Aham Brahmasmi jnanam. Jnanam is there. It is covered by your gubu 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 rising thoughts associated with the objects. They come and cover. Amazing, isn't it? Avriyate. Do you have to work very hard to forget your knowledge? Sukham. Easily you can forget the knowledge. Sukham is the adverb here, okay? Not actually adjective here. Sukham is what? Easily. Then, Vavriyate sada dukkham. Sorry, Vivriyate sada dukkham. Again, dukkham also means what? Adverbial here, word. Okay, dukkham also with the very, a lot, it's very difficult, alone, with lots of difficulty, Atma can be remembered. It's easy to forget, very difficult to remember. Vibriyate. With the difficulty alone, it can be remembered. Avriyate vibriyate. With the difficulty, Atma can be remembered. Easily, Atma Swarupam can be forgotten. We don't need to work hard, but to remember in all the situations also, to remember, this is an I am a father. With the reference to this person, I am a father. I am a father is what? I am only playing the role of a father. I am not the father. I am temporarily, father is a role which I am ordained to play temporarily. I am a mother is a role which I need to play temporarily. This whole life is a drama. Now, just obvious example, this drama business, okay? The whole life is a drama, and every actor, when he is in the green room, he remembers very well what? Happily he is putting on all the costumes, he changes. He has to go there as a beggar. Somebody's example, okay? Has to go and enact as a beggar, and he knows very how much money people have promised him to play this role also, he remembers. So happily he puts on the dress. He may be acting as a king also in other play. In one play he is a king, in another play he is a beggar. And in green room, as he is making up, now there's a makeup is done, and he remembers very well, I'm going to play the role. I mean, he goes to the stage and he remembers, definitely every actor remembers. He beautifully enacts his role. That's why people are all really whistle and then clap and then they applaud and then appreciate, and all the reviews come later on, next day pages, how beautifully he was just one with the character. No? All the star dust or something. No, whatever it is, every paper that talks about how well he acted his role, which means the actor remembers. Even though he plays the role of a beggar, he remembers well, I, the actor, am not the beggar. I'm not the beggar. I'm going to become rich after enacting this. Remembers very well. He's called what? Remembering while playing the role. When you remember what you are really, what you are not, I'm playing the role, he remembers on the stage. Suppose some actor goes there as a beggar and he enacts as a beggar. And he really takes himself to be a beggar. And he cries and cries and he acts very well. People praise him and go away, but he doesn't want to come out on the stage. Saying what? No, I'm a beggar, I'm a beggar, I'm a beggar. He continues to cry, means, and then the poor producer has to go there and slap him, drag him to the green room and remove all his the beggar's dress and give him his original dress which he was wearing. Now, come on. Are you a beggar now? Why were you sent to the stage to play the role? Are you a beggar? No. Dragging the person green room and making him wear his own previous real dress which he was wearing before he put on his the acting robes. That's called what now? Nididhyasana. Every time you have to drag yourself to green room of Nididhyasana. Clear now? Nididhyasana will help you. Only in green room, what now? All the wrong things can be removed. Is it clear or not? Because role play is something inevitable. In playing the roles, we have to remember it's all incidental. Temporary roles I've been ordained to play, but I am free from the roles. I am the consciousness, Turiyam Atma. This is something very difficult to remember. Is it easy to remember all the time? It's not that easy. It is very difficult to remember what I am always. It can be easily forgotten what I am. Therefore, he says, Dukkham Vivriyate Sada. And as I know, it is with the difficulty alone can be remembered, but easily it can be forgotten. Therefore, what happens if it is forgotten easily, this knowledge is forgotten easily, with the difficulty alone it has can be remembered. As a result of forgetting, then you go through samsara. Again there are problems, you easily become shaken and swayed, and you become afflicted by the situations in life, there is no mukti again. Is it clear? Therefore, yeah, what he says is, it is very important, Shravanam is very important, and after the Shravanam, the Jnanam, whatever you gained also, you have to be really contemplative upon what you have understood. Definitely, know how to contemplate on the Swarupam, how to be contemplative. Think of each word revealing the nature of the self, and each word which has been carefully unfolded in the class. Then, so dwelling upon the nature of the Atma, as which has been unfolded and understood in the class, in fact, will help us, what now, reliving the class. We have to relive the Shastra Shravanam. Reliving Shravanam is Nididhyasanam. All the time, reminding oneself of what one's real nature is very important in order not to be overpowered by the roles. Role play, we have to play in our lives. So we can't avoid playing the roles. Physically we cannot avoid the roles we have to play. Can we leave everything and go away? I'm not your father. You're not my son. Then go, get lost. You can't say that. They'll be around all the time. No? Where will they go? They'll all be there. You have to be there. Play the role as a role. But when you get up, remember, I'm getting up to play my roles, but at the same time, I am free from all the roles I'm playing. Before you go to bed also, definitely, I have played my roles, now all my roles very beautifully today. I'm free from all the roles I played. I'll ever be free from all the roles I need to play. I am consciousness. Every day, in the night time, when you go to bed, you must go back to your green room. Isn't it? That is very important. So he says, Aso Bhagavan, there is no Bhagavan other than your real nature, the consciousness. This consciousness, all pervasive, only reality, which alone is shining on the whole Jagat, that Bhagavan, the consciousness is what? Aso Bhagavan. Yasya kasya cha dharmasya grahena, easily when you interact with the world in playing your roles, easily forgotten. Very great difficulty alone can it is remembered. Therefore, if you want to make this knowledge effective, then definitely please be contemplative upon your real nature always. Please be contemplative upon your real nature. Okay. This is the verse 82. Now let's go to the 83rd verse, Karika. What he is emphasizing, what important lesson here? Jnanam has to be converted into Jnana Nishta, for which we need to be contemplative upon our own real nature, which we have understood through Shravanam. Understand? So meditation, contemplation is emphasized here indirectly. Why? Because knowledge can be easily forgotten. When do you forget the knowledge? When you happen to play your roles. You become the role. Isn't it? You forget your real nature. You have to play the role without forgetting your real nature. Like any actor does on the stage in any play. we should not avoid playing, we can't avoid playing the roles. We should play the roles, but we should remember the role as a role without forgetting our real nature, for which we need to be contemplative always. Successful actors you will be if you remember your real nature. Be contemplative is the indirect lesson here. Okay, after that, now he's going to the 83rd Karika. What he's going to say, let us tell you before I go there. Should I give you a break now? Okay, let me tell you the introduction and I'll tell you for the tea, I'll explain the class. See here, this first in this 82nd Karika, he explains how the interaction with the world, the contact with the external objects in the waking state can easily make a lay person forget his knowledge. An ordinary lay person who is exposed to the Shastram, who knows the truth, can be made to forget his understanding easily by coming in contact with the external objects is enough, isn't it? Whereas, not the lay people. There are people like scientists or great philosophers, and those people are not easily disturbed by the contact with the external world of objects. The worries and the problems, oh, my child's problem, my daughter's problems, my son's problem, my grandson's difficulty, you know, the people who, these are like, such problems do not really shake the thinkers, the scientists. The scientists, that's why people say, the scientists are like, really, like, you know, what people they are, no emotions. People always complain. Because they are not easily shaken by the worldly worries. Even though they are not easily shaken by the worldly worries, even though they interact with the world, still, even for them also, the self-knowledge remains covered. For a lay person, for an ignorant person, self-knowledge is covered by his ignorance. For the person who has done the Shravanam, he has the knowledge, his self-knowledge is covered by his worries, the worldly worries, associated with the worldly objects when he is interacting in the world. But for thinkers, not lay people, the thinkers, the so-called great philosophers, the scientists, for them also, knowledge is covered. Knowledge is covered by what? Not covered by the worries, you know, the problems which are associated with the objects or people they are interacting with, but the self-knowledge is covered by their own views obtaining in the form of their thoughts. All the philosophers, scientists have their own views of the truth. And the views they have from their standpoint, and they're all in the form of the thoughts, and those views obtaining in the form of thoughts cover the self-knowledge. Therefore, they also cannot be free. And here, Gaudapada Acharya wants to mention at least four philosophers. Okay, you go and come, have your tea and come back, I'll again.